I believe our next speaker is already among us, which is Barbara Muraca. We're very excited to have her among us today. And also, yeah, we thought if there was any two speakers that we could afford to have back to back, it would be you two. Since, yeah, among other reasons, we know you also publish quite a few things and are friendly outside academia as well. But yeah, just to briefly introduce Barbara, she is Associate Professor of Philosophy at the University of Oregon, USA, and her research focuses on environmental and social philosophy, process philosophy, sustainability and degrowth research, and political ecology. Now, we might mention also that since 2018, she's a lead author of the IPBES assessment on multiple values of nature, and she publishes internationally on relational values, degrowth, and sustainability. And her latest co-authored publication, From Planetary to Social Boundaries, or Societal Boundaries, An Argument for Collectively Defined Self-Limitation, appeared in Sustainability, Science, Practice, and Policy last year, and will form the basis of today's talk. Welcome, Barbara.
Yes, thank you very much. Can you hear me all right?
I think the sound is good. We'll continue on as is, I think, is fine.
Yeah, that's great. I think you must be exhausted. So let's have just 1 minute before I start talking after Matthias' wonderful presentation and a very interesting discussion. Let's take 1 minute just to stretch and breathe, both those of you who are at home and those who are there.
Yeah, if people are for it, we could like stand up, hands up, hands down, that kind of stuff.
Right, exactly. Have just this deep breathing and stretch. I can totally imagine how exhausted you might be before I come with the next loaded presentation. So let's really have a little bit.
Also, we do have quite a bit of buffer time with the lunch break. It is slightly shorter today, but we won't make it too shorter, I think, with this little time delay.
Yeah, okay. So, and you might also be hungry. So again, let's see what we can do. Let me just see whether this is working. Can you see the screen?
Yeah, perfect.
Fantastic. Okay. I want also to see you. So I'm rearranging my monitor. Unfortunately, I'm not where I was planning to be. And so I have just my very, very small laptop, and I'm going to try to do what I can.
We appreciate
presentation with a small computer. Thank you. And I really wanted to be with there in person also. It didn't work. And I'm so sorry. I hope there will be another opportunity. I have been looking forward to come to Ljubljana for so long, and then it didn't work. But we all deal with what we have to deal with. Okay, so my topic will not be necessarily focused on degrowth, because I have been asked to talk mostly about this last publication that Rock has mentioned. But I will at the end link it back when we start talking about autonomy and freedom as self-limitation to the degrowth narrative. I couldn't resist posting to the chat a contribution to one of the questions that came in the debate, and I hope at the end to have a possibility to go back to that, about why I personally think that degrowth, with this depressive sound, negative sound, is more powerful than any other possible narratives that might seem more attractive. But I want to go back to that at the end. So I'm going to talk today about mostly referring to the planetary boundaries narrative, which is very powerful, but there are some aspects that needs a more thorough critique. I just want to start by going back to this image that many of you might be familiar with, which is the classical image of ecological economics that originally only had the environment and the economy. Then it was added the society in the middle. This goes back to the origin of ecological economics by Herman Daly. It's a very classic framework. And the idea is that the economy and society are embedded in the environment. First of all, I think this was very powerful when it came out, but it's also extremely problematic. First of all, it's a very static image and represent the environment of the ecology as something given within which the economy is something different or human society are embedded. This is not the original idea of the what is considered the father of ecological economics, which is Nicolas Dujeskov-Rogan, who understood the economy as based as an extension of biological processes. So economic processes are just like biological processes, metabolic, organic, and therefore entropic. For Dujeskov-Rogan, the limit of economic processes is not necessarily an external size limit, but it's a limit given by the qualitative characteristic of metabolic, entropic, and qualitative transformative processes, which are irreversible, for example. So the limitation is, for example, the temporal rate of regeneration. That is a limitation that living beings all have to cope with. So I think it's important to keep in mind, and from the very beginning of various traditions of environmentalism, we had these two narratives, not necessarily competing because they were gesturing towards similar goals and they were working towards similar paths. But one is the idea of these circles of embeddedness. And the other one is what you find in more systemic approaches, the idea of a social ecological system. This is one of the many images that you can find as integrated, not just necessarily as one within the other. And there you see that the outer circle, so to say, is not just the biophysical condition, but also the social political ones. And this is kind of the summary of the abstract of my talk today, trying to stress more this other narrative that does not go into the idea of these static concentric circles as they have been articulated, in particular represented also by the planetary boundaries. I am not going to reject or criticize the planetary boundaries. I think the contribution is very important, but I want to add this perspective that comes from so-called critical social sciences and a group of scientists who worked together for years about these topics. I'm just showing other images very quickly, which without going into details, it is another narrative. I'm not going to explain it, that comes from feminist ecological economics, for example, and feminist economics in general, which analyzes the co-production and collab and interaction between human and biophysical processes. This is the image that I think everyone is familiar with, the image of the planetary boundaries that reproduces the idea in a way of the planet as a circle, as looked at from outer space. The planet is a globe and biophysical limits in different categories. Of course, this is a more complex representation than the one that I started with in ecological economics. But the idea is that there are biophysical limits within which socioeconomic and political decision-making takes place. And this is what we have challenged. I want to show you another image that I will go back to at the end of the talk, which is kind of my alternative image to the planetary boundaries. It seems to reproduce the circles, but it reverses what is the outer circles, which is really an appeal to the importance of starting with the way in which society articulates and negotiates its understanding of the relationship with the environment, nature, more than human others, and biophysical processes. Let me then briefly say what I'm going to address. I will start with articulating the planetary boundaries and articulate from a common publication, Strengths and Weaknesses, then focus briefly on the social dynamics, which are not articulated and not analyzed sufficiently in the planetary boundaries approach, in particular the growth imperative in capitalism. Many Many of these things have been already said by Matthias, thankfully, so I don't have to go into details. And then I will shift towards a possible alternative way of thinking, which is again going beyond these circles and to think from planetary boundaries to societal boundaries as collectively negotiated conditions for a good life for all. And I will articulate a little bit what that means as a form of a concrete utopia, reframing the very idea of freedom. This all is written in this paper that has been published, I think, last year in Sustainability Science Practice and Policy that Rock has already mentioned. And it's a group of people who have been meeting regularly at various degrowth conferences. We have had for years workshops in which we discussed the idea of limits. And this paper finally came out after years of collaboration, discussion, and debate. Let me just start quickly going to the planetary boundaries. I'm not presenting the planetary boundaries approach because most of you are familiar with it, but I want to say that they do refer to the necessity of an articulation that also comes from the perspective of social science, but they don't actually deliver, they don't do it. In the text by Roxom et al. In 2009, for example, there is a call for a focus on societal dynamics that have led to the current situation and transgress boundaries. Stefan et al. 2015 argues that planetary boundaries framework does not take into account the deeper issues of equity and causation and the drivers of what happened. There is a reference to the uneven distribution of causation and benefits, and that must be addressed. And finally, there is also addressing the understanding of the causes of the problem by Stefan et al. In the paper by 2018, that one of the points, the elements to blame is the technological lock-in and the socioeconomic inertia in human systems. The problem is that the planetary boundaries itself does not address this. It says that it needs to be addressed, but it does not. And this is something that is highly problematic because there are a couple of risks attached to that. So let me move on articulating some of what I consider the strengths of the planetary boundaries approach. First of all, it has widened the political an academic debate on the ecological crisis beyond climate change, which has dominated much of sustainability discussion. And not because climate change is not important, but because it has obscured other approaches. And the planetary boundaries is an approach to a more diversified account of ecological and biogeochemical forces induced by societal metabolism, including topics such as biodiversity or eutrophication. Planetary boundaries warn, the scholars in the planetary boundaries approach warn that complexity of interlinkages among different biophysical subsystems or processes are of utmost importance. And the resulting changes might be unpredictable in their extent and possibly irreversible. So it opens the discussion to something that is not only the focus on CO2 emission and climate change. Second, which I also find very, very important, is that it stresses the deep connections between geology, biology, and human and environmental history. It assumes that contemporary societies have become dependent for their flourishing on the stable environmental conditions of the Holocene, which are considered the necessary condition for complex societies. And framing it in this way reconnects the geological, biological, and human history in ways that are very interesting because humanity scholars, like environmental historians like Chakrabarty has, and other scholars like Donna Haraway has entered the conversation and the dialogue, focusing on environmental history that is not just the history of humans, but the history of humans' interactions with the environment. And it's also the history of more than human others. So I think this is important because it opens up the platform for the kind of conversation that I'm working out here. And the third one is immediately clear. The planetary boundaries image is powerful. It's a very powerful image that immediately represents the ecological crisis by representing it as the boundary transgression. It has a visual power that can trigger action and understanding. But there is also a series of weaknesses in the planetary boundaries approach, and I'm going to address some of them here. First of all, there is a call for analyzing societal dynamics, but there is no actual explanation of what in the planetary boundaries approach is called the predominant paradigm of social and economic development, which is considered to be responsible for transgressing boundaries. There are references to that without actually doing an analysis of what is this societal system and this predominant paradigm that does the job. We in the paper consider that it is not just economic activities in the abstract in general, it's not just human activity of a general understanding of humanity, but is a specific modality of framing economic activity under capitalism. I will go back to that later. Second, the planetary boundaries approach does not do that straight away, but the very framework opens up a perspective that supports solely or chiefly a globalized technocratic solution to the problem, and therefore ignores the social conflicts that are related to the problem itself and to the solutions. We do find some reference, for example, to going back to nuclear energy, to geoengineering, climate engineering, and we also have found some reference to that, direct reference to the necessity of geoengineering intervention also in the IPCC reports. The point that we make in the paper is that this technocratic drift is not just an accident, it's not just a byproduct of the approach, but is embedded in the view of the Earth from outer space. This idea of the astronaut point of view of the Earth as a globe, as a planet. And it is a view of the Earth, again, as a kind of cybernetic system that only experts and scientists can provide and articulate. The planet appears in its entirety as a kind of manageable, even to the complexity, cybernetic system, even though there are nonlinear feedback loops. This ignores the social conflicts that are hidden in the fold of that very globe, of the very planet. For example, the level of energy production so far guaranteed by fossil fuels cannot be delivered by renewable energies without significant trade-offs. We are already acknowledging that about the land. The land use, for example, surface for biomass, or the large river dams for hydroelectric power. These are all trade-offs which, given current embedded environmental inequalities and social asymmetries in power and wealth, would dramatically exacerbate social environmental conflicts worldwide and introduce more competition in the use of resources and also interventions such as geoengineering. I don't know whether you have been following, but most of them are happening in areas which are either racialized indigenous communities. And this is something that cannot be seen if you look at the planet from outer space. Connected to that is a risk of depoliticization of sustainability, because there is the idea that basically scientists frame the conditions under which politics is possible. And it risks creating what we call in the paper a new truth or orthodoxy that risks overlooking, as I said, differences, conflicts on the ground, and also the importance of the political debate about how to frame and structure societies. Linked to that is that there is no explicit articulation of normative and ethical assumption, also in the choice of the 9 planetary boundaries. For example, choosing biodiversity is a clear choice that has normative implication. And in the text, the authors referred also to ethical understanding of biodiversity, but there is no actual discussion. It's assumed, the ethics of biodiversity is assumed. There is a reference also to intrinsic values of nature, but there is no reference, for example, to ongoing debates that are brought to the table by indigenous community in the sense, for example, of biocultural diversity. That there is no articulation and engagement with the normative assumptions that are taken for granted in the paper itself. This also is because the spectrum of values worldviews and understanding that is at the ground, at the basis of the planetary boundaries approach, is relatively narrow and mostly rooted in Western perspective. So that other traditions, which are represented by, for example, the global environmental justice movement, by local communities and by indigenous community, are not considered. I mentioned already biocultural diversity, for example, and the plurality of ways of inhabiting the world that are not considered at all. That is not just a matter of consider other worldviews and other cultures, but also consider the issue of adaptation, for example, to climate change. The ability of local communities to adapt to not only climate change, but to the dramatic changes that are related to crossing planetary boundaries depend strongly on socio-political condition, as, for example, the native scholars Kyle White has clearly articulated, saying that the ability to adapt for indigenous community there is strongly dependent on the fact that they are confined in a territory. They cannot move from that territory under settler-colonial oppression. And what he articulates is that the condition for adaptation would be to have what he calls epistemic and ecological redundancy. So the possibility of having a larger repository of knowledge and also of ecological knowledge, and the possibility of moving and engaging transformatively with the environment, which is not given. So the question of adaptability depends strongly on political relations and asymmetric relation. Similarly, this is a critique that probably everyone is familiar with, is that the general perspective of the planetary boundaries talks about humanity crossing the and transgressing boundaries, but this is an understanding of humanities which is desocialized and completely dehistoricized. Who, which humanity, under which condition? And finally, the idea that within the planetary boundaries we could there would be a safe operating space, that also leaves unaddressed the question of distribution within the planetary boundaries and the issue of safe operating space for whom and under which condition. So the question of justice and different distribution is not necessarily addressed. In the paper, we then move on and try to open that black box that is not addressed in the planetary boundaries discussion, and that the one about the social dynamics that are considered the drivers of the crisis we are now in. And the social dynamics mostly are, as we point out, are rooted in the growth imperative, which is embedded in the capitalistic framework and capitalistic mode of production. What in the planetary boundaries is called the technological lock-in and socioeconomic inertia are produced by social structures of capitalism. Capitalist growth is not just a byproduct, but is deeply inscribed within our society. Matthias has already articulated that in details. This is why I'm not going into many details. I just use the usual image, and some of you might be bored if you have heard my talks already, but I keep going back to this image about, in order to make clear that Western modern societies as capitalistic society are growth societies. They're not just societies that also grow, but they are fundamentally organized around the growth imperative. And the image is the hamster on a bicycle, because the metaphor is that just like a bicycle cannot stabilize itself if it doesn't continue moving, the crazy bicycle of capitalist societies is that this bicycle has to keep accelerating, keep expanding and accelerating in order to guarantee to stabilize itself dynamically, and stabilize itself dynamically means to secure social stability, social mobility, pacification of the class conflict, etc. Also, there was so much to say about that, which I cannot go into details now, but the warning about the limits to growth in the 1970s were very much heard. It's not true that they were not heard. And in fact, the response to the warning from the limits to growth was the neoliberal restructuring of society as a project to save growth after the acknowledgement of limits to growth. To save growth, no longer, as Matthias has written, to support welfare state and some level of distribution, but to save growth for the privileged ones. This is an image from the early degrowth debate about the capacity to exploit. And I find this very interesting because after the crisis of the 1970s, the response was exactly to deal with limit by expanding them and expanding the capacity to exploit, not only literally, by building roads that enable more extractivism and going more massively into neocolonial and neo-extractivist projects, especially in the global south, but also an expansion that goes into spheres such as the sphere of our daily lives and daily practices, creating new needs, but also intensifying the pace of life and accelerating the intensity, in a way, of our work. This is the point that I made in the debate that was started earlier about whether degrowth can be a depressive term. And I actually think it is not, because with the neoliberal researching of society, the whole narrative of grow is a positive message. You need to grow in terms of develop new skills, enhance yourself, take care of your health, improve yourself, improve your employability on the market. This is all neoliberal narrative. And I think the power of the degrowth story is to counteract that neoliberal narrative, which has us running like crazy in the hamster wheel, and doing that willingly, because this is part of the story of wanting to improve oneself, self-actualize, self-enhance, et cetera. But I don't have the time to go into details. We might go back to these in the discussion. When we talk about the social dynamics, and I'm going very quick and cursory on this, we're talking about social dynamics of capitalism in different areas, the economic, which is the most obvious one, why this is a fundamental social dynamics that leads to the transition of the planetary boundaries because of the logic of the embedded logic of profit and not the focus on social needs. Institutional dynamics, we have already articulated how the state is implicated in capitalism itself. It's not a neutral regulator, which is why appealing to politicians to intervene without acknowledging the social dynamics and how the state is an actor in relationship to capital is at best naive. At the same time, the state is also a contested field. So it's also a place where contested social struggles can fight over the influence. In the social dynamics, there are also norms and values that are embedded as a narrative of growth, not only as a structure, not only as economic structure, but as I mentioned before, especially with neoliberalism, as what the German sociologist Harald Welzer calls a mental infrastructure, which is inscribed in everyday practices. It is almost impossible not to want to improve oneself, not to want to do sport in order to improve your health, not to want to learn new skills in order to improve your competitive position on the labor market. All this is embedded and inscribed so much in our mind and emotions that it's very difficult to challenge it. And it is one of the most fundamental drivers of the multiple crises that we're talking about. Another essential social dynamic has been already referred to also in the discussion and by Matthias about the unequal exchange in many ways between center and peripheralized zones, but also unequal ecological exchange, thinking of ecological debt. And there is more that I'm not going into. And again, if you're interested, the paper is also open source, so there is more into the paper. Let me now move to the second part of my talk about how to enter in a dialogue with the planetary boundaries, not rejecting the planetary boundaries, entering a dialogue to the planetary boundaries to design possibilities for a democratically organized future where the substantial conditions for a good life for all within planetary boundaries can guide politics and societal relations. The focus, what we propose, is a radical paradigm shift. And it's important to stress that we're talking about conditions for a good life for all. We talk about conditions and not achievements, because the actual achievement can depend on many different factors. We refer here also to the whole capabilities approach as one possible framework. But the substantial conditions refer to an issue of justice and political structures and infrastructures. Also, because this might imply that the achieved standards of well-being for some people needs to be reduced if these standards impede or hinder the implementation of conditions for a good life for all. The substantial conditions are the field of ethical and political contestations are not given one and for all. The other point that we bring in the discussion from the point of view of critical social sciences is that we not only focus on no-go in the sense of what should not happen, but also some essential must-haves from the point of view of justice, which includes particular principle access to resources and institutions that are necessary for a social ecological transformation. And what we also do is the question that we, who is participating and framing the discussion and participating in deliberation, or how this we, not only what is the we who is framing the discussion and participating in it, but also how a alternative or new we can be constituted in a subversive and radical way. And that also challenges the Western idea of prosperity and opens it up to a dialogue with other understanding of prosperity and well-being. What a radical perspective from critical social sciences can bring to the debate on planetary boundaries is not to close and shut down the space for moral and political debate, which is the risk that happens if we take that framework coming from scientific expertise, but keep it open and keep open the debate going. So not risk it to go into a depoliticization of the ecological debate. Also keeping the space open implies, for example, highlighting aspect of so-called epistemic justice, justice with respect to knowledge system. And the condition under which oppressed subaltern communities can articulate in their own terms value and knowledge and how it takes place. So what we propose is a kind of provocative terminology is to shift the dialogue from planetary boundaries to societal boundaries. And we define societal boundaries as collectively negotiated self-limitation in society. They're not given as such. They're always relational. They're a function of human intentions, actions, practices, and interaction. Shifting the focus from boundaries and limits to self-limitation emphasizes that this is a social challenge and a process rooted in forms of participation, collective self-determination, and democratic deliberation. It questions radically the idea of considering environmental problems in terms of a technocratic challenge to address, which can implicitly include shifting the boundaries or continuing with expansion all the way up the non-trespassing point. The idea is that societal boundaries emerge from contested social processes. They're not given as such, but are rooted in social struggles, leading to collectively defined thresholds that societies commit not to trespass. For example, with regard to poverty, inequality, ecological destruction, injustices, subordination, exploitation, consumption, and the like. The key point of moving towards the language of self-limitation is rooted in the necessity of guaranteeing the conditions for a good life for all. I already addressed the point about the conditions. I want to stress now the for all of the good life. So the politically and collectively negotiated self-limitation of societal boundaries is guided by the need to guarantee, as I said, substantial, not just formal conditions for a good life for all, which implies a redistribution and possibly also a reduction of the standard of life for some people in order to guarantee a good life for others. What is rooted in the planetary boundaries is also a kind of paradigm shift in the narrative. Instead of understanding the planet as scarce, it reverses the narrative and understands the planet as abundant, life as abundant, or as potentially abundant, as long as we limit ourselves collectively and make space for others to share the resources it has to offer in a responsible way among current living and future generations, and in a perspective of respectful cohabitation with non-human others. We think that this is a very powerful narrative that also enables a dialogue with non-Western tradition and non-Western perspectives, for example. Let me now focus a little bit more specifically on the concept of collective self-limitation, which goes back to the 1970s non-Orthodox Marxists like André Gortz, Castoriadis, and also the tradition of autonomism. The translation, the almost literal translation of self-limitation is autonomy. Autonomy means to give to oneself one's own rules and as act of a self-government. And autonomy can be intended individually or collectively, and we focus on both and how they're intertwined. There cannot be individual autonomy if there is not collective autonomy and the other way around. The narrative embedded in the concept of autonomy is a narrative of liberation. It is a liberation from norms, values that are kind of imposed or given to us from the outside, presented as a modality of something natural or naturalized. Think of Margaret Thatcher's famous sentence, there is no alternative to neoliberalism. This is a form of a heteronomous norm, or this is the market, and so there is nothing we can do about it. So the narrative of autonomy is a liberation from the opposite of autonomy, which is heteronomy or heteronomous, which means rules coming from the outside, from an other. So it's a liberation from heteronomous pervasive logic, for example, of the unfettered expansion and acceleration of growth society. In a way, it's a narrative of liberation from the acceleration embedded in neoliberalism and in the modality of capitalism. And this opened the possibility for collectively and democratically establishing rules that ensure social freedom and the conditions for a good life for all, as I said. We can also re-articulate the idea of autonomy in terms of framing conditions for a good life that are not, that means leading a life which is not at the expense of other human and non-human others. So there is a way, and I go back to that as a way of reformulating freedom, and I will articulate that in brief, as the freedom of not having to live at the expenses of others. And that as a positive component of a definition of what a good life can be. A good life is not the same as happiness, not just a superficial level of happiness. It's something like the old Greek mention of eudaimonia, is when you look back at your life and can consider that it was a good life, it was overall a meaningful life. Or the word eudaimonia literally means a life lived under a good spirit, under a good daimon. The idea of self-limitation and autonomy is not a necessarily completely new value in the society in which to live in, because it is embedded also in the liberal understanding of freedom. Freedom in the liberal tradition is understood is understood as the idea of independent individual self that is not determined by the external norms and therefore is free. In the more radical tradition of autonomism, freedom is intended as a social relation and a collective process of self-determination by a local horizontal and anti-authoritative practices. But these two narratives are not necessarily opposed. There is something common to them. And if we were to bring them together to its commonality, both tell the story, of autonomy as a value, as a collective, we would say, self-determination, instead of following even external norms, rules, or logic, such as I said, the logic of the global market or of acceleration, of enhancement, and of growth. So reversing the idea of freedom is from the idea that freedom ends, my freedom ends where somebody else's freedom starts. It frames freedom in a positive sense as a freedom, as autonomy begins with the self-imposition of limits to make space for the other. Because freedom as autonomy is only possible in a collective space, in a shared space. So it is a way of shifting the narrative towards understanding that it is not against, limitation is not against freedom, but is the condition for freedom of autonomy to make space for the other. And other can be human and non-human others. I mentioned this already about the freedom of heteronomy, and there is a level in which in the paper we go back to Karl Polanyi, articulating the idea of social freedom intended as not only freedom for the few, as Polanyi writes, but freedom for all, which means a freedom which is rooted in taking responsibility for the social and environmental impacts of actions on others. Matthias have referred to the imperial mode of living, which is exactly the definition of freedom, not for all, but just freedom for the few at the expenses of others, is a parasitic understanding of freedom. And as I mentioned before, I want to stress it here again, freedom as self-limitation is defined positively as the right not to have to live at the expenses of others. And I think framing it as a right is important because part of the constraints of the capitalistic and neoliberal framework is that we do not have this freedom right now. The freedom of a consumer is still a freedom that is embedded into drivers and mechanism and social dynamics and structures that in a way that do not allow us not to live at the expenses of others. So reversing it and fighting for a right to freedom intended as autonomy and intended as self-limitation can be a very powerful narrative to reverse the language. And it would also articulate freedom as an essential component for a good life. If I cannot exercise freedom in this sense and my right not to have to live at the expenses of others, I cannot lead a good human life in a normative sense. I want to conclude moving to the last part of my talk, talking about the good life for all as a pluriversal conception. The idea of freedom as autonomy and freedom as self-limitation is not new. It is present in many different articulations, both within Western and non-Western traditions. There are many ways in which the conditions for a good life are intimately connected to the idea of freedom as self-limitation, which is why in the paper we frame it as a pluriversal conception. And you find it embodied in social movements all over the world, alternative practices, laboratories for radical alternatives, post-capitalist communities, etc. And as I said, both in Western and non-Western traditions, in the global North and in the global South. Many of these alternatives are articulated in marginalized community, marginalized and racialized communities, for example, and spaces of resistance against the dominant system. Others arise within modern and industrialized societies, and sometimes also within sections of the middle class or elite urban population that are disillusioned with their own lifestyles and sensitive to the inequalities and unsustainability that they perpetuate. Examples of the former are social movements all over the world, global environmental justice movement, struggles against extractivism, post-development, struggles, the revival of struggles by indigenous communities in many places in the world, and not only in the global south. And there are a series of examples of this tradition within the West. I'm thinking of feminist perspectives, for example, right, which have been articulating a different idea of freedom rooted in the idea of care and a relational understanding of the self. To stress this again, this already exists. It's not a utopia, or it's not a utopia, it's a wishful thinking. This already exists and is embedded in many communities across the world. We have in many places models of freedom and self-limitation and the idea of societal boundaries. In fact, the majority of communities in the world already live according to this. It is important to frame the negotiation about the good life in its plurality and rooted in a pluriverse of different perspectives. As I said, I mentioned this already, sorry about going back and forth with the slides, but as I said, present in global south, in peripheralized communities, and also in industrial societies. And in the paper, I'm not going into details, but there are some examples of this from a global perspective that has been collected, for example, by Ashish Kothari. Again, I'm not going into that, I'm just showing you some approaches that have already embedded this very idea of freedom as self-limitation under different conceptions and different languages. I want to echo what Matthias has said, that degrowth is one of them, which has emerged in the global north, mostly in Europe, mostly in Southern Europe, for reasons that we can discuss if you're interested. But it's one out of many approaches, and this is where I'm going back to the image that I've showed you at the beginning, understanding the idea of freedom as self-limitation and the idea of societal boundaries. This is an image that is used to represent the Buen Vivir de Sumacausai discussion in the Andes, and it's a whole complication about where it ended right now, but at least at the beginning, it's interesting that it reverses the structure of the circles and gives the focus on the responsibility of the communities to build a relational space of self-limitation to embrace the relationship with more than human others as well. And I want to also stress how these various perspectives embody relational worldviews. For example, Arturo Escobar speaking from a decolonial perspective of a pluriverse of socio-natural configuration. There is no time for me to go into a detailed discussion of why the very concept of nature is fundamentally colonial. And we need to go beyond the idea of nature, society in that frame, also because there is a fundamental coloniality in understanding nature as a given, as that one thing outside other of society and culture, which was the foundation, the ideological foundation of Western colonialism. So understanding different ways of framing and embodying this relationship is a way also of breaking a profound coloniality. One of the languages that is embodied by environmental struggles right now is the concept, for example, of biocultural diversity. From the Anishinaabe tradition, Anishinaabe is a large population, the Potawatomi, for example, in North America, indigenous population. Kyle White uses the term of collective continuance, which is a way of articulating the understanding of the relationship between the people and the land. And it has a very different understanding of time and relationship and of governance, where the structures of governance are framed according to the change of the seasons, for example. There is a dynamic adaptability. Again, it's not about the limits and the structures, but it is a dynamic adaptability between biophysical, social, cultural, and political frameworks. Of course, this cannot be enlarged and become global. This is something that makes sense only locally, but it can be networked through alliances at a global level. And I want, this is another representation from the Menominee indigenous communities about their understanding of sustainability and sustainable development, for example. There you see how complex these images can be framed, but I don't want to spend too much time. I just want to conclude saying just a few words about degrowth. And Matthias has already talked about that, so I don't need to go into details, but this is the alternative image that degrowth represents for me. You remember the hamster on the bicycle? We need to change the frame of the bicycle, because that particular frame of the bicycle is fundamentally dependent on the acceleration imperative of growth and capitalistic growth. This is a different bicycle. This is also commons-based, a commons-designed bicycle, so it can be reframed, restructured, it can be turned into a cargo bike. This gives a sense of the idea of degrowth not as going back to the Stone Age, but as going forward towards rethinking technologies, for example, in the sense of convivial technology, rethinking social practices, and rethinking the idea of movement. This bicycle moves, but is not necessarily dependent on the imperative of acceleration embedded in the crazy bicycle of the hamster of growth. This is also a critique of degrowth in a way, because you see in this bicycle is mostly white people sitting. Degrowth is embedded and comes from a European framework, which is okay, but this is why it's not something to export to others, but it's something that can enter a dialogue, and this is exactly the power of what Matthias has articulated as the growing movement, can become either a platform or a contribution into a variety, a pluriverse of alternative perspectives. What degrowth can do is that it unveils the contradictions of the growth logic and question the economic structure and the cultural infrastructure that justifies it. And this is why I hold onto degrowth, as I said at the beginning. I don't think it is a negative narrative, but precisely because of it, it articulates the liberation from the cultural infrastructure of growth, not just the material structure of growth. It unmasks the tale of prosperity of the global north rooted in capitalistic growth and development, and displays its parasitism on other human and non-human others. And it embodies radically different values. And the degrowth narrative, which is heterogeneous, is rooted in a narrative of freedom as collective autonomy, as self-limitation, and of conviviality. Again, this would require going too much in detail, but I think one of the key assumptions of degrowth is to rethink human being as being in relation, as being fundamentally relational, and in conjunction with the global commons movement, a fundamental value that is forwarded is the idea of conviviality and solidarity instead of competition. And competition is one of the core elements of neoliberalism and one of the core drivers of growth. I mentioned this already, and I want to stop here. I've probably spoke for way too long, and I look forward to the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Barbara. We're opening the floor for questions, and we'll probably go over about 5 minutes, but no more than that.
Hi, Barbara, thank you very much for the inspiring contribution. I feel like I need a bit to defend the planetary boundary community, since I work with climate scientists myself, and I've actually worked for the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research for Johan Rockström. Even though I was not involved in a planetary boundary research myself, I was surrounded by people that were. I absolutely understand all your criticisms of it. But I would also like to point out that the planetary boundary people also do understand those criticisms and are aware of them. And what I would like to say is that it is a work that comes from a different ontology, from a different, like, is speaking to like a different public. And therefore, it has this shape. And it is, of course, it's full of like, it is, it should be criticized, but at the same time, it is open to criticism and it is self-aware of criticisms. And then what I would wanted to ask you then to comment on, I'm sure that you're aware of the work of Kate Raworth from Oxfam. And she has, for example, introduced what she called a social floor to the planetary ceiling. And so she essentially constructed like a limit, like a lower limit of lower social limits and a planetary outer limit. And she said we should live within this livable space of this donut. And I wanted to like ask you, like, if you can compare your work to Katie's Raworth's contribution, but because also Katie's Raworth's contribution was endorsed and co-authored by, for example, Johan Rockström from the Planetary Boundaries community. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. I appreciate that very much. And as I said, this our critique is more a kind of a critique within a high respect of the work of the Stockholm Resilience Center and the larger community of the Planetary Boundaries. Not a rejection of the framework, but it's a kind of pushing it to articulate more clearly this aspect. As I said at the beginning, in the text itself, there is reference to the need of doing this. I understand that it is not done in the text, first of all, because no one can do everything. And secondly, because I appreciate what you said, that it was targeting a specific audience. And I think this is relevant and important, but it's also, but I think the point that triggered us was that there is a danger also in targeting that audience, in framing a narrative of, first of all, a narrative of embeddedness, instead of a narrative of complex system dynamics. But I also know that the complex system dynamics are part of the actual analysis of the planetary boundary. So this is more of a critique of the representation. I find it problematic in terms of in how little reflection there is articulated in the papers. And I know that the people working behind that have done more reflection on that, but how little reflection there is in the paper about the risk of technocracy. Because there is a way in which if we take the scientific expertise as guidance, and I am not questioning science, because it's always the risk that someone, I'm not questioning that there are biophysical thresholds. This is the language I would rather use. But it reduces the space for the political debate to the point that then technocratic solution and managerial solution seems to be the only path to go, which is a particular modality of operation of neoliberalism. If one thing is characteristic of the neoliberal restructuring of society is that it moves away from the political debate to a managerial approach of solving problems. And there is a danger attached to that, that might be, instead of being part of the solution, might become part of the problem. But I definitely want to acknowledge that the people who have worked in the planetary boundaries community are very aware of this. And I also know that there are more recent papers coming out that work on that. For example, from the Stockholm Resilience Center is also this one important contribution to the so-called relational turning sustainability. And I'm sure that this is also linked to this debate. So I look forward to see. This paper was a provocative paper they put out there, calling for a closer attention, first of all, to capitalism and naming the problem, instead of having this general understanding of humanity as the problem, and also a call for a higher attention to the diversification and the plurality of approaches and things that are already happening out there in the world, in terms of differentiation of a lens that forwards justice, both in the terms of who is being affected, but also in terms of who is actually already doing something. And there is so much is already happening out there with risks being actually eliminated by intervention that call themselves to be intervention, technocratic intervention to reduce the transgression of the planetary boundary. So it's an appeal to be careful. The donut model, I wanted to add it in my slides and then I didn't because I thought it's too much. But yes, it is a very important limitation. It's a very important addition to the planetary boundaries perspective, the idea of the corridor. And there are other approaches like that, talking about corridors between too much and too little, in a way. And the safe operating space is not just a space within the planetary boundaries, but also a space that has a minimum in terms of social requirements. And I think this is a very, very good corrective to the problem, some of the problems of the planetary boundaries. I still consider that problematic because it still has this idea of embeddedness, instead of thinking the dynamic in which whatever we call nature or the environment is co-constructed, is co-materially transformed by human practices and human activities. And I think that we need more of that, not only because, and there is a lot of that, of those perspectives, social metabolism analysis, for example, but also in non-Western perspectives in terms of the importance of these practices, transformative practices. So I still would contest the idea of the concentric circles, because it mediates an understanding that reproduces some that reproduces problems, for example, a colonial understanding of the relationship between nature and society. But I do think that the donut model is a very good model and can be operationalized and can be very helpful to guide politics. So I don't want to reject it. I'm just saying I want to add on that perspective more radical critique and also an appeal to look into pluriversal perspectives, if that makes sense.
Yeah, thank you very much for the very inspiring lecture. I wanted to make two comments, because what you argued today compelled to me to think in that direction. So first, listening also to the previous lecture on degrowth, it kind of gave the impression that the discursive space has undergone a kind of a colonial enclosure of epistemologies that are basically making us focus exclusively on growth and seeing nature as something entirely detached from society, the economy. And I think this fetish around growth, even in degrowth, is not or cannot be overcome perhaps if we don't decolonize that way of thinking first. And that reminded me a little bit of the question that Robin asked before, also on the role of the state. Because when we talk about all these transformations, we're fixed with the state as being a key player in the process, but at the same time we kind of forget that the state, Karl Polanyi would say, has been creator, facilitator of the capitalist system since the very beginning. So without state, there's no system. So what I think is truly radical about what you were presenting today is this idea of freedom as autonomy that brings us to reflect on the alternatives, not only beyond capitalism, but also beyond the state. And looking at it from a perspective from extractive economies in the global south, I kind of had the feeling that this idea of autonomy can be seductive enough for wider audiences, not only in the global south but also in the global north, to go beyond this idea of growth. No, like to reclaim autonomy as reclaim freedom. I think to put it in some way, it can be a marketing hit if we make it like that, because we need to make it viral as fast as possible. So perhaps going in that direction, what reflections have you and the group that did that that paper? What have you thought about making this idea of autonomy as freedom, or freedom as autonomy, making it viral?
Thank you so much. This is an amazing, there's amazing things you said there, and I really appreciate you sharing that. So first of all, let me just say something about the state. There is also a paragraph where we address in the paper the role of the state. I am not the most competent person to do that, but yes, the problem is that we seem not to be able to think of societal coordination that are not framed in the form of this national state, but the national state has not been there forever. So there might be other formation that indeed can be embodied in terms of concrete utopias that need to be experimented for the future. And I'm not sure my ability of radical imagination is enough to represent that, but I do know that there is in a lot of anarchist literature there are possibilities and also problems attached to that. So I think that is important to keep in mind that the state is a player and a facilitator, as you said, of capitalism, is a player in relationship to capitalism. I think it's also important to consider that the state is also, as I briefly mentioned, a contested field, because it is not only that. The way in which the state has related to capitalism has changed in different historical and social formation from the kind of the period, the post-war period, where the state was mostly spearheading a kind of decommodification of health and education and other social and other services. But thanks to economic growth, we need to keep this in mind, to the neoliberal state, which is a completely different role in relationship to capitalism, to other possibilities. So I don't want to completely give away the state. I think that because the state is a contested field, but I also think there is so much that is happening outside or in the pockets. I also have learned after living in the US for several years that it depends, the state can be a friend or an enemy depending on your social position. And for many racialized social groups, the state is mostly the face of the oppression. So there are reasons for which we need to be very critical about the role of the state, while at the same time not being naive about just thinking as if the state wasn't there. And I don't have an answer, I don't have a solution, but I think this is part of the answer, and part of the solution is really to go into framing radical alternatives. And I think the non-reformist reform perspective is one of those which Matthias had presented. The last point you mentioned is great about autonomy. I hold on to degrowth for the reason that I briefly mentioned. I understand that there is a fetish because the language of degrowth reproduces in a way the reversed fetish of growth. But what I read in the DE of degrowth is the narrative of decolonization. So it's the negation that opens a liberation. It's a radical space that is opened via a negation. So I hold onto that narrative personally, but as I said, degrowth is one way, is one model. And in a way, at the very beginning, I mean, Andra Gors was probably even the first one, or one of the first one who even used the term décroissance in the 1970s, and he is one of the thinkers of this idea of autonomous self-limitation. So the link is very, very close. I like the idea of talking about autonomy as self-limitation, as collective self-determination in the sense of social freedom, as a way of, you know, a marketing label. I'm not sure I want to impose a marketing label. I think this is a way in which a dialogue can happen. If it happens, then it's welcome, right? And we see how this is taking place. It does, for example, in dialogue with Eko Swarai, the radical ecological democracy movement in India, because Swarai is a key moment of understanding autonomy from a Gandhian point of view, but it might not work everywhere, right? So this is why this is kind of the caveat that I want to keep.
Thanks so much. I think we have time for one more question.
Another test, yeah, okay. Hi, this is Sophie Bichel from Drift. Thank you so much for your talk. I'm very inspired and moved. I love the idea of having the right not to have to live at the expense of others. I think that's a very beautiful sentiment, but also a strong one. And I also really respect that beyond concepts like the donut economy that was mentioned, there is a lot of space for a pluriversal interpretation, and this also localized, giving meaning in a localized sense to what this self-limitation means and what this new sense of freedom means. But I, as Matthias also mentioned, we know that we also have this global disparity between the people who might need to self-limit a little bit more than others. So I wondered if you could speak to this relation between a sort of localized embeddedness or a local interpretation of these concepts and these boundaries, while at the same time trying to extend solidarity at a global scale.
Yes. Ooh, yes. I'm not sure how to address that, because the key point of the reframing freedom as the right of not to have to live at the expenses of others is addresses that, at least in its utopian narrative. When I say utopian, I don't mean just something abstract. I mean something very embodied in practices as a concrete utopia. But it is already the narrative of the global disparity and the need of a reduction on the one end in order to make space for others to reach a minimum conditions for a good life, in the narrative of a good life for all. I guess where I'm stumbling here is about operationalization. And what is the authority that can implement that, right? Because we are talking here about radical alternative in the terms of a narrative and values, which is very important. But then you have also social movements that embody that, and that happens at the level of struggles. So the claim is already embodied by social movements calling for what you said, that some people need to limit more than others. And this is not just the global north, global south perspective, but following Uli Brandt and Markus Wissen and their idea of the imperial mode of living, there is a global north in the global south and a global south in the global north. So the point about the imperial mode of living is that it's not just geographical, but it's framed in terms of a parasitic and imperialistic way structured around the capitalistic formation of societies that is fundamentally parasitic onto others. And again, these others might be in other regions of the world, but also maybe racialized community or along the axis of gender within the countries of the global north, or the poor, simply. So I think that is the idea of freedom as the right not to have to live at the expenses of others is the reversal of the imperial mode of living. In a way, you can have them as one the reversal of the other. It's what addresses and attacks and rejects the modality of an imperial mode of living. I think the focus here is to articulate, is to highlight the constraints in which we're all embedded. It's not easy as an individual to stop doing that, because we need structural and infrastructural changes in order to be able not to live at the expenses of others. I'm not sure, honestly, I guess this is not an answer and it's not satisfying for sure. I guess what I want to say that the global disparity can also be addressed by using these two opposite frameworks. And it can only be enforced via social struggles, because otherwise I don't see an authority that can come and do it. In fact, the tendency that we have right now, because of scarcity, as we can see also with the war, is just in Ukraine, is just the opposite, right? Who can appropriate and guarantee for their own population or for some members of their own population access to resources? And this always goes at the expenses of others.
Thank you so much, Barbara.